Good day. Thank you for joining and welcome to another consultation and discussion for the study of environmental and social risk assessment and management consultations of the Asian Development Bank. This consultation forms part of the stakeholder engagement that supports the Safeguard Policy Review and Update Process, or the SPRU, as you may hear us refer to it as. It's nice to see so many new as well as returning colleagues joining and showing interest in the environmental and social risk assessment consultations. My name is Azim Manji, your consultation moderator for this session. This is our 11th thematic consultation topic or theme so far, and this is the third in a series of consultations and discussions on environmental and social risk assessment. In today's consultation, we're joined not only by Bruce Dunn, the Director of the Sustainable Development and Climate Change Department in the ADB, but also by Ryder Kwam and also Charles Deleva, both of whom are internationally recognized specialists in this area. Other experts, including Zara Abbas, Felix Oku, and Madhu Gupta are also here and joining in the consultation and will be presenting materials and engaging with you for the discussion as well as responding to feedback. For this third session on the environmental and social risk assessment with CSOs in East Asia, Southeast Asia, and Pacific, we have 69 participants pre-registered, and we hope this number will grow as the consultation proceeds. 52 of the participants are from outside the ADB network, which is encouraging to see. Although most of you were in previous thematic consultations, we're also joined by a few newcomers, mostly consulting firms in the region, including Pacific Applied Services Consult, Finnish Consulting Group, and Tuan Pak Environmental Consulting. We have at least three advanced questions that have already been submitted prior to the start of the session, which is very encouraging. In this consultation, Mr. Ryder Kwam will present the main summary issues related to topics associated with the study he has authored on environmental and social risk assessment and the relationship of the study of relevance to the safeguards policy update. From the presentations, we are hoping participants like you will share insights into the potential gaps of the provisions and implementation of the previous policy and propose recommendations to ensure the strengthening of the forthcoming or future revised policy. Comments received from this consultation will inform the revision of the ADB safeguards policy. Before I call upon our speakers, here's a few gentle reminders. All stakeholders and participants, as you've seen when joining, have consented to the recording and the distribution of this meeting. This is for the purposes of preparing a summary of the meeting, and it is the intention that these recordings will be available to ADB staff and consultants, and then, of course, more broadly to all members of this consultation publicly. If you have any concerns about the recording or distribution, please contact us at the email address posted in the chat box. Please join from a quiet, distraction-free area, ensuring your microphone is off or muted when not speaking. And when called upon to do so by Mr. Felix Oku during the Q&A session, please ask your questions by either typing them into the chat box or raising your hand in the Zoom feature. Mr. Oku will then ask you to unmute yourself and, if you wish, turn on your camera so that you can ask your question live. We're all colleagues here, and as a collegial group, just a reminder to please be respectful to everyone, and Felix and I will help us manage our time to keep within our schedule. IT support is being provided, and you may ask for any additional IT support by typing your issue or query into the chat box in any of the languages we're using today, and someone from IT tech support will be able to assist you. As we're joining by Zoom, here's a few guidance notes when using Zoom's important buttons. Aside from English, we have simultaneous interpretation in Chinese, Bahasa, Khmer, Lao, and Vietnamese. To access the simultaneous interpretation feature, click on the globe icon found on the lower part of your screen and select preferred language. Press the mute original audio button so you can hear the voice of your simultaneous interpreter clearly and not the person speaking in English. For those of you listening in Chinese, Bahasa, Khmer, Lao, or Vietnamese, if you feel that simultaneous interpretation is too fast or that the interpreter is struggling to match the pace of the English speaker, you can ask the original English speaker to slow down by going to the bottom of your Zoom screen and clicking on the reactions button. When you've clicked on the reactions button, you can press the slowdown button, which is two reverse arrows in white pointing to the left, or the speed up button, which is two fast forward arrows in blue pointing to the right. This will let the English speakers know to speed up or possibly slow down. We ask that you use your proper name in Zoom for our documentation. To change your name on Zoom, click on the Participants button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will then be able to see your own name. Click on the More button over your own name, and then click the Rename tab. You can then type in your name, agency, and then click OK. If you wish to send a message to us or to all participants, share a feedback or ask a question, click on the chat button. If you wish to comment or raise a question live in the language you prefer, click on the smile icon or the reactions button at the bottom of the Zoom screen and then click on raise hand. To speak and unmute yourself, click on the microphone icon towards the left. And then to show your video just beside the microphone icon, click on the video icon. We value diverse and informed feedback from our wide range of stakeholders, so let me refer you to the slide on ADB's commitment to meaningful consultations, which appears on your screen now. Just another friendly reminder that these sessions are being recorded and documented and will subsequently be distributed for each event. You've consented to this. This allows the ADB to review, to consider, and respond to, if necessary, any comments and inputs made. If you wish to opt out of the recording and/or distribution of these recordings, please contact the Secretariat through the email address that appears in the chat box now. If you have any issues or concerns on recording, confidentiality, potential risks, abuse, or any other kind of discrimination during the course of these consultations, please get in touch with the Secretariat through the same email address that appears on the screen, as well as what's in the chat box. During this consultation, we have about 2 hours. Here's what we have planned to maximize both your time as well as ours. Firstly, Mr. Bruce Dunn will provide his welcome remarks. As I mentioned, Mr. Dunn is the director in the Safeguards Division of ADB Sustainable Development and Climate Change Department. Secondly, we'll have Mr. Ryder Kwam, who will share the main issues and findings of the nature and context of the study that he has co-authored on the environmental and social risk assessments as related to the revision of the Safeguards Policy Statement and its forthcoming update as well. After these presentations, we will have a brief 5-minute break, and when we resume, we will be joined for our third presentation presented by Ms. Zara Abbas, a Principal Environment Specialist within the Safeguards Division at the ADB, who will frame the discussion and set the context for the Q&A portion of the discussion on environmental and social risk assessments. Following Zara, she will hand over directly to a moderated discussion facilitated by Felix Ney Teti Oku, a senior social development specialist also within the Safeguards Division at the ADB. This will be the Q&A session that runs for about 70 minutes. And Felix will remind you again that you can share your experiences in the chat box in either English, Chinese, Bahasa, Khmer, Lao, or Vietnamese, or through raising your hand as I explained using the Zoom functions. Felix will prompt us all with guide questions to frame the conversation, and then we'll have a quick evaluation before turning us back to Bruce Dunn to give us a wrap-up and indicative next steps following this consultation. So without any further ado, let me call upon Director Bruce Dunn for his welcome remarks. Mr. Dunn, if you please.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Azim. And good day, welcome, and thank you for everyone joining this regional consultation on environmental and social impact and risk assessment as part of the update of ADB's safeguard policy statement. As Azim has mentioned, this is the 11th thematic consultation topic that we have held so far since starting the consultation process in last November. We've held a range of topics focused on the potential policy architecture, as well as different topics on environment, as well as involuntary resettlement, Indigenous peoples, stakeholder engagement, and also lessons learned from ADB's accountability mechanism. And today's session on environmental and social impact and risk assessment is a quite critical one because it actually provides the framing for understanding and assessing and then managing risks across the entire project cycle. Now, moving forward, we'll be undertaking still further consultations. In fact, we expect to hold about 20 consultation topics from the start and then running through till about May and June this year. So still quite a lot to go, many different topics that we need to consider as part of the safeguards process. Now, we're pleased to welcome, of course, many of you that are coming back. Looking at the participants list today, I see many familiar faces that have been joining us throughout these consultations, and that's fantastic. We always welcome you back, and it's important that we do have a dialogue and look at the entire perspective of the policy. There are, of course, people that are joining this session for the first time. So for those, let me just provide a very brief background into the policy update. Now, we commenced this process in August 2020, and that followed an evaluation of the effectiveness of ADB's existing policy, the Safeguard Policy Statement, or SPS for short, and that was undertaken by ADB's Independent Evaluation Department. They looked at the implementation over, you know, really the last 10 years, and then they made a series of recommendations. One of the most important was that ADB should update and modernize the policy, building on the evidence from previous implementation experience, as well as from recent safeguard policy updates by other multilateral financial institutions. And of course, in the 10 years since ADB's policy was developed, there have been many significant and important updates by other multilateral institutions that work with similar stakeholders to ADB and with similar types of financing modalities. So we're looking very carefully at their policy frameworks and what we can learn from them. In addition, the Independent Evaluation Department made other recommendations which looked more at ADB's own systems. They recommended that we strengthen our own oversight and monitoring framework. They recommended that we develop additional guidance and supporting materials for the policy. And they also recommended that we strengthen our staffing, skills, and capacity. And that capacity program involves, of course, our own staff, but also for our developing member countries and for our private sector clients. Now, the update process is expected to be implemented over about a 2.5-year period. And at this stage, we are targeting the development of the new policy for ADB's board consideration by March 2023. And we're actually on track at the moment for the preparation of a first full draft of the policy by about September this year. Once that's available, we will then go into further rounds of consultations on the actual draft. So the regional consultations that we're undertaking today and through this period are intended to inform the development of the policy. We're producing background papers, analytical studies, which look at further implementation experience, as well as the frameworks of other multilateral financial institutions. And then, of course, we're having these consultations to get feedback, and that will then inform the design of the policy. Now, you can find further information on our website. There is a background paper and also the stakeholder engagement plan, and you'll also be able to see the full schedule of upcoming consultations. And just to note there, we have made a number of changes to the scheduling as we work to finalise some of the papers and to keep a reasonable schedule. So there are some changes. And for those of you that are not already registered, you can register for updates. We'll then send you email information. Just have a look over also for the chat, because we'll provide some links there. So that's just a bit of background for those that are joining the call for the first time. Now, coming back to today's consultation topic, we're going to be focusing on environmental and social impact and risk assessment. And as I said, it is a very critical area. And before we go into the presentations from my colleagues, there's just four key points that I'd like to mention, really as some framing for the later discussion. My first point relates to the scope of risks that need to be assessed. Now, currently within ADB's existing SPS, we are required to undertake screening and assessment of project-related impacts and risks in the context of the project's area of influence. And in practice, this tends to focus on primary project sites, as well as associated facilities, and it covers a range of potential direct and indirect impacts, as well as cumulative and induced impacts that could affect the wider communities. However, more limited attention is given to the wider context in which a project takes place. For example, a project could be implemented in a fragile and conflict-affected situation. It could be where there is weak governance and capacity. And in these cases, there's likely to be greater challenges and risks, and may require additional measures and support to implement it effectively. Thus, we feel that the risk assessment process really does need to be strengthened, and it should include consideration of wider contextual risks and management capacities. My second point is then on integrated assessment. ADB currently screens and categorises our projects separately for environment, for involuntary resettlement, and for Indigenous people safeguards. And while these three areas will still remain part of the policy, and it's still very important that we consider and understand the detailed impacts and risks in these three areas, what we have seen is that consideration of interrelated environmental and social impacts between and across these areas really does need further consideration. We tend to be fairly siloed in the risk assessment process and then also at the implementation. And we've seen in a number of projects that this has led to gaps where information on the wider social context has not been fully considered across the three areas. So this also needs to be strengthened. My third point is on understanding a project's impacts and risks to vulnerable and disadvantaged individuals and groups. Now, the SPS does already require this. There is focus particularly on considering risks to poor people, to women and children, and Indigenous people. These are given explicit attention in the policy. However, there are, of course, wider considerations, and we do need to have more robust social analysis for the project area so that we can take into consideration the full scope of vulnerable and disadvantaged people that should be considered. There's a range of issues here which need more explicit attention. For example, people with disabilities, people from different ethnic or cultural backgrounds which could face differentiated risks in the context of projects. There could also be consideration around different gender identities and intersectionality issues between a range of different risks. So these all need further consideration. And then my last point is on the need for more adaptive and risk-based management approaches. Now, currently, the policy focuses really on the assessment of potentially significant impacts and risks, and generally requires impact assessments to be prepared in full prior to project approval. So in practice, we tend to front load a lot of the assessments. And this is important, but it does happen regardless of the level of risks and regardless sometimes of whether a project has undertaken detailed designs. And actually most of our human resources, due diligence and appraisal efforts focus on this very early stage. And one of the things that the IED evaluation pointed out is while that front-loaded approach has been fairly strong and has led to generally satisfactory results in terms of the quality of projects prepared at that time of board approval, greater focus is needed on implementation. And we feel here that there is a need for a more risk-based approach. Certainly projects that have high levels of risks or substantive levels of risk need more significant upfront preparation and management, but we also need to give much more attention across the entire project cycle. And then for projects with lower risks, there may also be opportunities for more streamlining and flexibility in terms of balancing the level of preparation before and after board approval. But this is something that needs careful consideration. I don't think we've come to a final determination on this yet. We're wanting to look carefully at it and we need to get it right. And this will be an important area, I'm sure, that you'll have views on today for the consultation. So these are just a number of considerations around the assessment of risks, the integration of risks, consideration of poor and vulnerable groups and disadvantaged groups, and also adaptive management. Those four issues I think we'll come back to during the subsequent presentations and of course during discussion. So I'm looking forward to hearing your views today with any questions, comments, and of course recommendations. And following the presentation, we'll have about 75 minutes for that discussion. So let me now turn over to two colleagues for presentations. Firstly, Mr. Ryder Fum. He's working as a senior advisor for ADB and has been looking at this area. He has a presentation and that will be followed by my colleague, Ms. Sarah Abbas. She's a principal environment specialist in ADB who will discuss briefly some of the directions that we're thinking about. So with that, I'll finish and I'll pass over to Ryder. Thank you again.
Thank you very much, Bruce. And good morning, afternoon to all of you. It's very nice to be with you. My background is I'm a social anthropologist. I have worked as a senior manager and global lead for the World Bank and the IFC, and I have worked inside the Inter-American Development Bank and the IDB Invest on environmental and social standards and work as an independent advisor now. If we could have the next slide, please. So what we wanted to summarize in this discussion were some highlights from a study that we did looking at the 2009 Safeguards Policy Statement of the ADB and comparing it with a number of other multilateral finance institutions, what has evolved as a converging agreement on good practice elements and topics to address in risk assessment and management. We've looked at some of the gaps and we've tried to propose ways in which the Asian Development Bank can incorporate current good practice. This is done on the basis of a rapid desk study of information that is publicly available. The study does not look at actual performance in individual projects, but looks at the overall policy statements and standards. Next slide, please. These are the six comparator institutions. And as you know, these all have safeguards policy frameworks, environmental and social frameworks that are more recent than the Asian development banks. The AIIB was last updated just last year. The World Bank's ESF became effective in 2018. Of these, the oldest is actually the IFC performance standards from 2012. But these form the basis for the architecture. All of the other MFIs have adopted frameworks that largely build upon the integrated approach that IFC first introduced in 2006 and then updated in 2012. So the others are the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, the Inter-American Development Bank, and the private sector part of the Inter-American Development Bank Group, IDB Invest. Next slide, please. As I said, this is just a brief summary of some of the highlights and issues. We've looked more systematically at different topics, but we thought we would focus on some key aspects along the lines of what Bruce just highlighted now. So what has emerged as good practice and more standard practice is to expand the scope of social topics addressed in the risk assessment and management process to balance the environmental and social issues better. Secondly, far more systematic, greater attention to identifying who the stakeholders are, both those affected positively and negatively by projects, and those who may have an interest or be involved in different ways in projects and can affect their outcomes. The movement from a predetermined set of impacts to accepting and understanding that all projects involve uncertainty, and uncertainty is about risk in these areas. So developing this as a comprehensive and informed risk management system is where the architectures have moved. There's also greater clarity on relative roles and responsibilities between the financial institution and the client or borrower, whether that is a sovereign country or a private sector company, for example. We tended to focus a lot on upfront procedures and documents, as Bruce said, and I fully agree that that remains essential to make sure that the planning is as robust as it can be. But we sometimes in the past, and I have been guilty of this, being responsible for this at the IFC and the World Bank, we mistook documents often prepared by external consultants for outcomes and results. What we've learned, of course, is that this needs to be tracked systematically through monitoring throughout the project cycle, far greater emphasis on implementation, and recognizing that circumstances change, that new risks that we had not anticipated may occur, and be able to respond to those in an appropriate way, which is what we generally then now refer to as adaptive management. Some institutions have also nuanced how they categorize risks, going from what has usually been a three-tier system of category A, B, C, to a four-tier, more dynamic risk categorization. The World Bank's ESF, for example, uses these four levels of high, substantial, moderate, and low risk. And this is different in another way also. The earlier risk categorization was quite static. It was established once and for all. It looked at pre-mitigation risk assessment, whereas now what we have is more of a dynamic risk categorization that can be modified. If additional risks become apparent, the risk categorization can be elevated from moderate to substantial or even high. It may also be reduced if it turns out that the mitigation measures prove to be robust and effective. All of this to say that the new frameworks are less of a rigid blueprint on how to do things under all circumstances. Since they take more factors into account, there's also more variables involved. And it does require judgment, a degree of flexibility, and the appropriate sequencing of actions, which we'll talk a little bit more about. Next slide, please. I apologize that this slide is a little bit difficult to read, but many of you will be familiar with this in general terms as a type of illustration of typical risk management frameworks now. They're often established at three tiers. The blue on top, that level, is about aspirational goals and objectives. And it typically involves going above and beyond risk management in individual projects to looking at how an environmental and social assessment and management process can contribute to sustainable benefits and opportunities. So alignment with the Sustainable Development Goals, for example, alignment with international conventions, such as the ILO conventions and other international agreements and views on sustainability. Gradual realization, for example, of human rights objectives, greater alignment towards more climate resilient investments and opportunities. The next level down are the mandatory requirements. And these are now typically divided into two levels. At one level, you have the key policies and standards, which focus a lot on principles, objectives, and expected outcomes, both for the lending institution on the left and for its clients on the right. The lending institution will generally have a set of policy statements or just one policy statement that talks about how they will perform their roles and duties in this regard. It'll talk about their due diligence process, their risk categorization, their follow-up, client oversight, and implementation support. On the client side, there will be a set of standards, typically based relatively loosely, I should say, on the IFC performance standards. These have been adjusted and adapted and updated by different institutions to also reflect more recent lessons on issues that are important that were not perhaps well enough addressed in the performance standards. So you, in some sense, you could call this a performance standards plus approach to client standards. The next level down on the mandatory requirements are about procedures and organizational structures. This is about management systems, having a normative framework, having the procedures, having the assessment methodologies, the ability to manage risks, the management support and resources for this in general. And then the second red box, the one in the middle, is about how to adjust this to different types of lending modalities and financial instruments. A technical assistance operation, a grant, a direct investment project, working through financial intermediaries, or development policy-based lending, or even a strategic policy dialogue, country diagnostic. These will all require somewhat different procedural approaches and organizational structures. And that's meant to be reflected by this once that has been established, that there should be some degree of flexibility within that area. On the client side, similarly, there would be management structures, environmental and social management systems that would be developed proportionate to the type of portfolio managed or to the individual project as appropriate, reflecting risk, scale, complexity of this and proportionate to that in how it is structured. The green box at the bottom would symbolize or summarize good practice notes, guidance, tools, knowledge products, shared lessons learned, dialogue among different MFIs, civil society organizations, academic institutions, and others to develop common approaches and shared knowledge around these issues. This is non-mandatory, but it's an ongoing and evolving set of issues. And as you will know, IFC, the World Bank, ADB, and all of these institutions have issued on a continued basis in-depth studies, good practice notes on different topics, whether it is on cumulative impact assessment, on risks of retaliations, on broader implementation manuals and guidance. So that's sort of a very typical and simplified version of what current policy frameworks tend to look like. If we can move to the next slide, please. As Bruce mentioned, we have expanded the types of risk factors that we're looking at. In terms of the first point, the direct and indirect adverse impacts that a project may cause or contribute to, we have broadened the scope and, if you like, raised the bar here when it comes to social issues in particular. A number of social topics have been incorporated to broaden these frameworks to go beyond resettlement and Indigenous peoples, which have been safeguards policies for many years. And this is now done in a much more balanced way with environmental considerations. Secondly, risk factors that would affect a project and its impacts on people and the environment would have to take account of inherent risk factors in different sectors. A large mining operation, a large hydropower dam would inherently be far riskier and more complex than, for example, a human development project in health and education. The third point is particularly important. Well, these are all important, but we haven't always looked sufficiently at the third point in the past, and that is about the operating environment in terms of vulnerability and sensitivity. Whether we are operating in areas of high biodiversity value, critical natural habitats, areas characterized by resource depletion, prone to natural disasters, and climate-related events on the environmental side. And on the social side, the presence of vulnerable or disadvantaged groups, whether that's done on the basis of issues like gender, sexual orientation and gender identity within that, ethnicity, Indigenous peoples, persons with disabilities, age-related factors, literacy, poverty. There's a number of factors that can constitute vulnerability to project-related adverse impacts, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a later slide also. And as Bruce mentioned, we've sometimes ignored contextual risk factors in the operating environment. These are pre-existing to the project. They were not caused by the project, but the project may exacerbate them. One example of that was I recently was involved in doing a country-level social analysis in Somalia, in East Africa, and many local groups, civil society organizations, pointed out that the mere fact that a project supported, in this case by the World Bank, could come in, could raise tensions and contribute to more violence with conflicts over land and resources that the project might bring with it. So the projects may exacerbate these pre-existing situations of fragility, conflict, and violence, but they in turn also affect how the project affects people and the environment more directly. People who are subject to fragility and conflict, who are internally displaced, will have far less resilience to the project-related impacts. Governance and corruption will affect how a project is managed and how effectively mitigation measures can be handled. There are third-party risks, there are settings with higher degrees of human rights abuse. All of these considerations are issues that a robust risk assessment should take into account. And finally, one thing we have also not perhaps looked at well enough in the past are all the issues around whether or not we have robust enough management systems and structure to address these issues, both on the side of the lending institution like the ADB and also on the part of clients. Are there the right management systems? Is there capacity and experience? Are the right budgets and other resources allocated? Is there political will and commitment? So this is just a way of grouping different risk factors and looking at how they interact with each other, because these interact with each other. And risk assessment becomes a combination of considering these and other variables. So you cannot very easily have an indicative list and say, by definition, this type of project is high risk or this type of project is low risk. It really depends on the setting and on many other factors. Next slide, please. Let's try to illustrate this issue of how different risk levels may affect what you actually do in a project. This is a typical project timeline. The dotted line would be when the project is approved after concept preparation, appraisal, negotiations, and legal agreement signed. And then you have a series of actions during implementations also. This would vary depending on risk levels. So if we click on the next segment of this slide, this is meant to illustrate that projects of these different risk levels from low through moderate, substantial, and high. And if we click again, a project of low risk, these green balls are intended to indicate actions required. So it could be a study, it could be consultation events, it could be specific mitigation measures. In a low risk project, there would be fewer of them. Each of them would require less effort, and more of them could be sequenced into the implementation period and done later to provide for flexibility in low risk circumstances. But a high risk project would be different. So if we click again, these red balls are meant to indicate that in a high risk operation, there would be significantly more required. Each action would require substantially more effort, likely cost and time involved. And more of them would have to be done prior to approving a project. This is not to say that we would then drop the ball, so to speak, referring to these red balls. We would not be dropping the ball during implementation. On the contrary, high-risk projects require significant involvement, effort, actions during implementation also that would need to be monitored systematically throughout. Next slide, please. To illustrate this, some of the things that might be done during implementation, depending on the circumstances, might be finalizing a biodiversity assessment that would have looked perhaps at animal migration, but not covered all of the seasonal variations. So you do want to extend this and update it at a later stage to get a clear sense of what is going on. A stakeholder engagement plan that you prepare before a project is approved would always need to be updated as issues evolve, as designs are finalized, and as different impacts and opportunities related to different stakeholder groups become apparent. It could be that we started out too simply perhaps and just looked at households, whereas a more nuanced view of this would indicate that we should do a gender disaggregated intra-household analysis, and that could be updated later on. You could always say, well, we should have predicted all of this upfront, and in an ideal world, perhaps we could have, but in reality, we constantly learn new things, and we should be open to adjusting and adapting our planning and our implementation and mitigation measures. Similarly, a framework for resettlement with key principles and approaches could be developed where we don't know where the impact areas are going to be, but once you have those, you need site-specific resettlement action plans, and they could be developed as appropriate during implementation. Now, if we click on this, we wanted to illustrate that this needs to be sequenced appropriately. There is a critical path here. You can continue with studies and consultations. Click next, please. These studies and consultations with stakeholders should be reflected in how plans and designs are finalized and updated. This would then, with the next click, indicate that we would undertake mitigation measures, such as relocation of people being resettled. And the next click showing that this has to be done before adverse impacts that potentially affect them, such as the start of civil works, use of that land occurs. So the project planning during implementation will need to look very, very carefully at how these different things are sequenced to ensure that no adverse impacts take place before the appropriate studies, consultations, and mitigation measures are put in place. Current frameworks summarize these in a commitment plan or an action plan established as part of the project's legal agreement. But that also has a degree of flexibility because we recognize that there are unforeseen circumstances that may occur, and these commitment plans and action plans can be updated. Next slide, please. So this is something that I have worked quite a bit on over the years and published some handbooks and guidance on also, how we integrate environmental and social assessment. First of all, we, as I know that you're all familiar with, we try not to think of environmental and social assessment as a simple study with a report to be disclosed. We think of it much more now as a process throughout the lifetime of the project. And this is meant to be illustrated here by the shape of an umbrella. It's an umbrella process throughout the entire lifetime of the project. It has environmental considerations on the left. It has social topics and considerations on the right. And it has a number of cross-cutting issues where these overlap. In reality, they're all interconnected. Environmental issues are considered important because they have value to people and to our planet. And ecosystem services affect how people use natural resources that they depend on. Pollution prevention affect people's health and safety. And similarly, social impacts affect the environment generally. So this is a simplified version, but it covers a number of topics. Now, one thing which is apparent about this is that this needs to be done, again, with the appropriate expertise. Very few people would have deep technical expertise in all of these topics. I certainly do not. But what we would expect is that any project, through early screening and scoping of potential negative impacts on the environment or on people, should identify key issues that require further scoping, more detailed study, more detailed consultations, and more systematic mitigation mechanisms put in place. So you would draw in expertise, do specialized studies as required. But we don't always have resettlement. We don't always have projects that affect indigenous peoples. So this is also very context specific. Next slide, please. Bruce mentioned that we have a particular focus now. We try to ensure that the distributional impacts of a project. We recognize that there may be winners and losers, and we certainly try to ensure that adverse impacts on all groups are recognized and mitigated as appropriate. But we're particularly concerned with impacts on vulnerable and disadvantaged groups for these four reasons you see here. First of all, negative impacts such as displacement will affect them more severely. They may have less resilience to shock and adverse impacts than other groups. Secondly, even if there's no negative impact directly from the project, even project benefits such as health and education may involve groups that have systemic barriers or elements of discrimination or language barriers or be persons with disabilities, any number of social identities that may prevent them from accessing the project benefits. And the assessment and consultation process reflected in project designs should address these issues. Thirdly, disadvantaged and vulnerable groups generally have less influence, less voice, less agency. The stakeholder analysis, the stakeholder engagement plan, and the engagement in appropriate forums and mechanisms, whether it is through public meetings, focus groups, individual discussions, and use of media. This combination of consultation practices and methods should be adapted to the needs and to the concerns of each category of stakeholders, with particular emphasis, as we say here, on vulnerable and disadvantaged groups. And finally, the fourth point, going above and beyond risk management, how can the project be targeted and designed in such a way that it doesn't just restore baseline conditions, but provides real benefits to vulnerable and disadvantaged groups? How can we target these benefits, for example, by empowering Indigenous communities in the project area through capacity building or other aspects? Now, if we can click on this slide again, one thing I wanted to highlight here is that, of course, social identities do not exist in isolation. They overlap. An Indigenous woman who is illiterate, poor, with a disability, will have a series of disadvantages that may act in a cumulative way or as risk multipliers, if you like. This is what we know as intersectionality, where different categories of marginalization, discrimination, or other types of disadvantage can affect each other, whether it is on the basis of gender, location, age, ethnicity, sexual orientation, or other aspects. So this is part of what the assessment process should try to capture. Next slide, please. In the assessment process, and I don't think we'll have time to go into all of these details, this is just meant to illustrate that the assessment process is not a point in time, as I said, the assessment and management process, but it's an ongoing and iterative process throughout the lifetime of the project that has different elements at different stages of the project, identifying risks, identifying benefits, identifying who the stakeholders are and engaging with them throughout the lifetime. That's that long bar, the third point down. Again, apologies for this being difficult to read. This is taken from some recent publications. Developing the right management systems, ensuring that these issues are implemented well, monitored, that consultation processes continue, that studies, risk identification, other aspects continue during implementation. These all affect each other, and they affect the project design and management decisions throughout. Next slide, please. So just to end on this slide, this is just a summary of some of the topics that were highlighted in the study and based on recent experience. An integrated framework, assessment and management, not as a point in time, but as an ongoing process with three key pillars: the analytical part, the participatory part, and the operational management and decision-making part. Better targeting on gender disadvantaged and vulnerable groups, the recognition that there are different clusters or categories of risk and they influence each other. We just talked a little bit about the assessment process as ongoing throughout the lifetime of the project, and a critical path approach to balancing pre-approval actions with actions during implementation, and a degree of proportionality, we would require a great deal more effort in higher risk operations, both on the part of the lending institution and on the part of the borrower and other clients. So with that, I think I have used up my allotted 30 minutes. So I'll say thank you for your attention so far and hand it back to the moderator.
Thank you, Ryder, for the wonderful presentation and also for providing us with clarity and feedback and some of the comparative IFI processes related to the environmental and social risk assessment study, and in particular, the issues related to the four-tier dynamic risk categorization that you've just presented, and the suggestion that efforts and requirements be proportionate to project risk and scale and complexity. And I'd like to also thank Director Bruce Dunn for framing and contextualizing the discussion. We hope that we can get further feedback from you on what the ADB should consider in these general policy topics and areas during the facilitated Q&A session that will run for around 70, 75 minutes. And as I said, there's some flexibility in this. But let's first pause for a 5-minute break. Before we actually move to the break, can I invite you to think about a poll question that we will have a little bit later that you could perhaps think about now. The poll will be introduced to you on an app called menti.com, which is posted in the chat box. So before you head off to get your tea or coffee or other favorite drink, just a heads up that we will be asking you about how specifically we can improve the level of engagement, the level of discourse, the level of interaction and discussion with you on the menti.com questionnaire that we will have coming forward. If you have 5 or 6 or 7 sentences that you could add to contributing to this idea of how we can better engage with you as stakeholders, we'd love to hear from you. And when we return, we'll have the third presentation, as Bruce Dunn mentioned, by Zara Abbas, who is a principal environment specialist with the Safeguards Division. And then Zara will hand it over directly to Felix Teti Oku, who is a senior social development specialist, and Felix will moderate the Q&A discussion. So you will see a countdown timer on the top right-hand side of your screen that the guiding questions have been flashed on your viewer to consider over the break, and these are the questions that Felix will take us through. We already have some pre-advanced questions, as I mentioned, but when that countdown timer reaches zero and when the music begins to fade, you'll know that it's time to return to your screen for Zara Abbas's presentation that will lead into the Q&A session with Felix Oku. So with that, let's take a brief 5-minute break and we'll see you all very shortly. Thank you very much. Thank you very much and welcome back. We will now have a framing of the risk-based approach that ADB considers as presented by Ms. Sarah Abbas, a principal environment specialist with the Safeguards Division. This context will lead directly into the environmental and social risk assessment study as facilitated by Felix Ni Teti Oku. So without any further delay, let me please introduce Ms. Zahra Abbas, a principal environmental specialist within the Sustainable Development and Climate Change Department. Over to you, please, Zahra.
Thank you, Azeem, and good morning, good day to everybody. So as Azeem just explained, I'll just help you with giving a bit of a background and help you with the starting the discussion off in the next session. So in the previous presentation that was presented by Raidar and also the background given by Bruce, you just heard about the risk assessment and management approach that over the years has become good practice in considering the impacts of development projects. So in order to implement an integrated risk assessment and management approach, we see that ADB will need to align with the practice adopted by our comparator MFIs. And in doing so, we've identified some areas for strengthening. So yes, there. Thank you for the slide. Yeah. So these areas are there's a need for having an integrated risk-based classification system for strengthening environmental and social impact assessment, introducing adaptive risk management, strengthening safeguards oversight, and there's a need for a robust capacity building program for ADB borrowers and ADB staff. I'll just go through this briefly. So currently, ADB undertakes a significance-based classification of projects, and this is undertaken separately for environment, involuntary resettlement, and Indigenous people's safeguards. So we have separate categories for each, safeguards and for each project. In the revised policy, we will consider an integrated risk-based classification system in which there will be one integrated categorization undertaken across all safeguards standards. And this will be based on the location, nature, the scale of impacts as it was done previously as well. But most importantly, we will be factoring in the borrower's capacity and other contextual risks as was just explained in the earlier presentation. As part of the environmental assessment process, the current practice to screen, categorize, and assess project impacts will need to be revised and adapted to incorporate an approach that considers the interlinkages between environmental, social impacts, and risks. The ESI, the environmental assessment process, needs to focus more attention on how to address the impacts which are faced by disadvantaged groups, vulnerable groups, how gender are affected by these. So presently, these are being done by ADB, but the process is not integrated together. Social assessments take place, initial poverty assessments also take place, but how can we better integrate them and see how certain environmental impacts can have social consequences and vice versa. In view of these interlinkages, guidance for integrated social and environmental impacts will also be strengthened. Next slide, please. So here I will briefly introduce the next steps that we will be taking to introduce the risk management approach. Most importantly, to ensure the delivery of safeguards outcomes, ADB will focus on strengthening project implementation as well as supervision. So to implement a risk management assessment and management approach, ADB will need to apply the principle of adaptive risk management. Now, this involves ongoing monitoring of projects and the ability to respond to any unforeseen circumstances or risks that may arise during implementation. So, and linked to this is the need to also develop guidance on how to balance pre-approval requirements with actions that can be undertaken later based on the level of risk during project implementation. So explained by Ryder, more effort will be needed for higher risk projects during the due diligence stage, as well as during implementation, and closer supervision and tighter management of the mitigation options as well. So based on the nature and risk of the project, actions that may be undertaken at a later stage need to be then agreed upon with the borrower and then crystallized into an action plan and which is agreed and which is which can become part of the legal agreements. What the World Bank does in this situation is that they prepare an environmental and social commitment plan, which is a legally binding document, and that lists all those actions that need to be undertaken later. So having a new approach and guidance is very important, it is equally important to strengthen ADB safeguards oversight, which will require robust risk management systems. And these include appropriate safeguards, staffing structures, resources, performance indicators, tracking and performance monitoring tools. So what we're doing at the moment is that we have recently developed and are implementing a project performance rating system and an integrated safeguards management system for tracking the implementation of project level safeguards. So we expect that by the time that the policy revision and update is completed, ADB will also have reviewed and assessed the staffing resources requirements. So, and lastly, a comprehensive policy implementation plan will be developed for capacity building and establishing strategic partnerships. This will cater to the needs of all stakeholders, and stakeholders include executing agencies, implementing agencies, and contractors, consultants, engineering consultants who are in the supervisory role for projects. Partnerships with the other MFIs will also be strengthened around the standards and implementation practices. So, and along with this, we will develop policy guidance, good practice notes, and other tools that will assist with the implementation of the policy. So I hope that this background of the topic that was presented earlier and how we're considering to incorporate it will give you the context needed for addressing the next questions, which are on the next slide, please, that will be discussed with you by my colleague, Felix. And we look forward to a good discussion now. Thank you so much. Felix, over to you now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Zara. For that contest to the Q&A session. So I welcome all of you, about 74 of you are in the call to the Q&A session. This is your session, this is your time. ADB values your feedback to the ongoing consultation process on the safeguards update and would encourage all of you to provide that feedback within the 70 minutes allocation that has been given to us. We've got quite enough time, but we know we've got quite an interesting subject here as well. From the presentations that has been offered by Bruce, Ryder, and then the lastly by Zara. To make that facilitation and feedback process much more easier, we've made sure there is a simultaneous translation for four other languages, I think five other languages beyond English, that is in Chinese, Bahasa, Khmer, Lao, and Vietnamese. So you're not obliged to speak English in the language, and use English as your preferred language, you could go to any of these five languages that I have mentioned and speak the language of your choice and ask the question. And the simultaneous interpretation would allow us to make sure we provide a response to you. Where in terms of how you can post your questions, comments, and feedback, you could use the chat platform. You could raise your hand, which is a preferred way as well. And we will be able to admit and see that you've raised your hand and we'll call you. You could also use the chat box. Some of you have already sent advanced questions for our response. So we thank you very much to that effort. Beyond that, the consultation is going to be ongoing up until the SPS is completed. So beyond this session, if maybe for time constraint purposes, we're not able to reach out to you or you have follow-up questions to a response that has been provided to you, there will be email circulations that will be sent and you could also reach out to us and we could reach you to bilaterally to clarify further. Without much ado, I think we could kickstart. I will encourage all of you to, don't feel shy, speak up. It's your time to have questions. We've had quite a lot that has happened. Bruce is giving the background. Ryder has given the benchmarking exercise that has been done, comparing ADB's SPS to sister or comparator institutions. And then Zara has also put some kind of a context to how we currently implement and provisions to strengthen our safeguards, even ahead of the SPS, the update process. So we encourage all of you to ask questions. Looking to now, we've got two questions ahead. In terms of the order, we'll go and pick maybe the questions that has been sent in advance. Then if we see a hand that has been raised, I can't see any yet, we'll call the hand. And then of course, if you put a question in the chat box as well, we'll pick that up, okay? Why don't we start with the question that we received from Claire Forbes. Claire, if you're on the call, please let us know by unmuting and if also convenient, putting the video on so we can see you, if you're on the call. I guess when we checked the last time you weren't on the call, but if you will, let us know. Claire Forbes, Claire has mentioned, Claire is a senior SNL specialist, Cardinal, Australia. And Claire's question says, how can risk be properly identified early in concept phase and risk be managed according to principle of proportionality? I think I would pose this question to Ryder in the first instance. How can safeguard risk be properly identified at the concept stage of project preparation or processing? And then how could we manage them in accordance with the principle of proportionality? Rather than touch on the four-tier dynamic risk assessment or risk categorization process. I think maybe Claire would want how we could implement this in practice. Maybe you could share if your studies touched on feedback or implementation experience from the World Bank approach. Over to you, Ryder.
Thank you, Felix, and thank you to Claire for the question. I understand it's also about early identification of risks. And so one of the issues that we have tried to stress more and more is the importance of involving environmental and social specialists on the client side, on the side of those actually responsible for identifying risks and for managing them, whether it is a private sector company or a government agency, but involving environmental and social specialists from the very start of the project. In the past, we have often seen that the physical design aspects, financial management, procurement, all of these things were established relatively early, and then only later, once it became apparent that there might be adverse environmental and social impacts, were environmental and social specialists brought in to try to mitigate these things. What has been adopted now is a completely different mental model, if you like, or I would call it a paradigm shift, in that the assumption now is that environmental and social issues are not just addressed as externalities to projects, but they're an integral part of how project decisions are made from the early stages, design and implementation. Now, the actual identification of individual risks happens gradually. As I think I mentioned, there is an early screening of the project, proposed project, the setting, the populations affected, and that would then identify areas to focus on. So when we talk about screening and scoping, one comparison that I like to use, I'm a photographer as a hobby, I take a lot of pictures, and the early screening is more like using a wide angle lens on a camera. You capture a lot, but you don't see a lot of detail. Once you have a sense of the overall landscape, you put on a telephoto lens and you zoom in on particular topics that are more relevant in that particular setting. So you zoom in on the resettlement aspects, the biodiversity issues, a study if there's significant potential pollution, ecotoxicology, specialized study. And so this happens gradually, but I think key to it is to ensuring that on both the client side and the financing institution side, like the ADB, that the appropriate expertise to address these issues is present from the very, very outset and start of the project cycle. That has not been the case typically in the past, and it is a way that we need to change how we are working.
Thank you very much for that detailed response, Raida. I think we're getting a bit more hands being raised now, which is a positive sign. That's good. Let's make it quite very interactive and very interesting. I said this is your session, so let's grab the chance and ask all the questions that we've had on all the presentations that have taken place so far. Next, we called Rayan Hassa from the NGO Forum on ADB. Rayan, if you could unmute, put on a video and just voice out your question, that would be a break from several ADB talks now. Yes. Thank you very much, Rayan.
Thank you, Felix. And thank you, Zehra and Ryder, for the overall presentation. And as you know, NGO Forum on ADB is closely looking at the safeguards update, and we've been through multiple consultations before. So my question is basically on this one paragraph in the summary document, paragraph 22, where I think it's basically stating that it is preferred to have a safeguards policy which clearly delegates the role of the client, but separating the role of the bank from the safeguards policy or from that particular policy document and keeping it somewhere else. Now, I do have personal concerns regarding this, because when you look at this from local communities' perspectives and those who want to understand what their entitlements are in terms of safeguarding, they have to clearly know what is the responsibility of the bank when it comes to, say, EIA assessments and SIA assessments and information disclosure, and what is the role of the client. And it is better to have both of those things side by side in the same policy document. You can't expect illiterate, far remote, non-English speaking local communities to understand where processes and policies pertain to them when it comes to big infrastructure projects. So that's one. And we have seen problems on that kind of nature. I guess the Tata Mundra case, the EIA documentation missed out and the SIA documentation missed out on the seasonal fishermen. And there was lapses within ADB's machinery on rechecking those EIA documents and SIA documents, where that group of people were missed out in the original evaluation. Now, if the policy itself did not identify the role of the bank and bank officials when it comes to categorization, it will be deeply problematic looking for accountability through the accountability mechanism, because we don't know what the role of the bank is. So that's something which would reinforce. My I do have two follow-up questions, and I'll go over them quickly so I don't have to come back again. On the four-tier risk categorization, I think in Ryder's presentation, he mentioned that during the implementation stage of the project, this may be a moving target. So a project may move upwards from moderate to substantial to high risk, or it may even move lower if risk mitigation approaches are taken and et cetera. Now, what we would like to know is, what is the decision-making architecture for moving up or down in terms of risk categorization? And the reason why I'm emphasizing on this is, in our experience within the ADB decision-making tree of safeguards and risk assessments, we know that the safeguards machinery is not all in one place. This came out from the IED report. SDCC is housed in a particular way. Safeguard specialists are housed in a particular way. We've talked about this before in previous consultations. So I'm very, very curious to know how the decision-making of risk categorization moves up and down. And also, are there checks and balances that after consultants have evaluated, are there second layer, third layer checks and balances of these risk assessments before they go to the chief compliance officer for categorization? Last point is on the four-tier risk categorization. I think in the first presentation as well, they said that it would apply to financial intermediaries, to technical assistance, to policy loans and such. Now, would it be the same method of risk categorization, say for FIs? We know the FIs have practically not performed on safeguards delivery as per the IED 2015 report, and later on in the recent report as well, no safeguards documents have been uploaded. It's very difficult to even identify projects on the ground and to figure out that ADB financing was related to it, let alone delivery of safeguards. So there is promise on this, what was presented, but we would really like to see how it's going to be implemented for sure. And lastly, it was a pleasure to see Ryder. I don't know if he remembers me, but back in his Norwegian 8 days, 25 years ago, I was a little kid. He was working with my mother, Zakia's son. So I'm sure she's going to say hi at some point. But thanks. Over to you, Felix.
Thank you very much, Rayan, and your historical connection with Ryder. I'm sure he will come back and touch on it. You know, you've sort of highlighted a few issues which I think we need to unpack. And I'll start with your second one, which I will direct to Ryder, on the benchmarking work on the four-tier dynamic risk assessment. I think your main concern over there is you want to know what will be the triggers for the dynamism, whether the recategorization goes up or down, because we said it's dynamic. The word you use is the decision-making architecture, which I think is what will be the triggers, given that this categorization could go up or down. And you've highlighted that this is a big concern to you because of the ID findings of the siloed nature of application of safeguards in ADB currently. So I will ask Ryder to touch on that. And then a linking question to that as well has to do with whether this four-tier dynamic risk categorization process will be applied to all financing modalities or instruments. You mentioned in particular concerns about FI and, you know, the delegation of banks' duties. If they were supposed to be doing this, then those triggers need to be clear with that. Ryder, would you be able to take those two questions? And then the first question you ask has to do with responsibilities and roles on ADB, and then the borrower and the client. You think it's very, very important and that these are clearly spelt out. And that will go to Bruce in the first instance as well. So, right, if you take the four-tier dynamic risk classification question twofold. One, what will be the triggers for that dynamic categorization during project implementation? And then whether that would apply maybe in the work bank contest as well, whether that applies to all project financing modalities or instruments. Over to you, Ryder.
Thank you, Felix. And can I just say on a personal note, what a pleasure it is to have Ryan here. He's absolutely right. His mother and I spent a lot of time traveling around in villages in Bangladesh looking at civil society projects that we were trying to support when I worked for the Norwegian Embassy in Bangladesh for a number of years. So please give my very best to your parents. Thank you. So on the dynamic risk categorization, I cannot speak to how internal checks and balances and decision points within the ADB currently are, or how they are expected to be done. I can speak to what other institutions have done here. I think a very important aspect of this is the fact that we now consider capacity and performance related issues and resourcing of these issues, the effectiveness of mitigation measures as an element in risk management. And risk, to use sort of a classical definition of risk, risk is a combination of two factors. It's the potential severity of a negative impact if it occurs on people or the environment in this case. How severe is the impact? And that has to do, for example, with how vulnerable the population is, what the biodiversity setting looks like. The second factor is how likely or how probable it is that this will in fact occur. And of the two, we try to weigh severity of potential impacts more heavily than we do likelihood or probability, without getting too technical about this perhaps. Now we cannot do much with the severity of an impact. What we can do is to reduce the likelihood of the impact occurring on the probability side. And we do that through applying the risk mitigation hierarchy of identifying, avoiding, minimizing, mitigating, compensating, or offsetting for any residual adverse impacts. The more effective those mechanisms are, the less the negative impact. And it's the effectiveness often of those mitigation measures that we do not have always a totally clear picture of during project implementation. We can have plans often prepared by consultants, but consultants do not have management authority over decisions in a project. So this is about management decisions. It's about overall project management and the effectiveness of the mitigation hierarchy, how it is applied, how the mitigation measures are managed, become apparent during the implementation. So this, if it proves that this performance is unacceptable, if I were the responsible person here, I would elevate the risk level. I would say that this is a higher risk level than we thought it would be, because although this looked straightforward, performance, capacity, resourcing, timely recruitment of specialists, these are not taking place the way we had hoped, and this now constitutes a higher risk. So that's one way it may go up during implementation. The opposite may also happen, right? So it is something that will need to be monitored very carefully throughout the entire process. I think there's a value to having it as a dynamic factor, because if we say this is now a higher risk project, we will allocate more resources and more support and more attention to it and more oversight. So we don't manage this mechanically, we manage it in a dynamic manner. I mean, I could speak quite a bit lot more on that, but I hope that sort of addresses parts of what the question is. I appreciate the question also on the relative roles and responsibilities, paragraph 22 of the paper, as Ryan pointed out to, but I think that was for Bruce to respond to a little bit.
Yes, but then maybe from your study, Ryder, did that four-tier dynamic risk classification apply to all financing modalities, for instance, in particular with the World Bank?
Not necessarily. This primarily has been applied in investment projects. The World Bank has adopted the four-tier system, but the World Bank's environmental and social framework does not apply, for example, to development policy financing. It applies to investment financing. whereas the Asian Development Bank in the past has applied this to different financial modalities. And there's a discussion about how and whether to continue that, is my understanding. I would say that the policy principles should be exactly the same, but risk categorization would be based on different criteria. In a financial intermediary system, you cannot separately identify risks of every individual client of that financial intermediary and every sub-project separately, because they can run into the tens of thousands on a large-scale program. What you do assess is the risk of the management system that that financial institution has developed to manage environmental and social risks, do their due diligence, have the right requirements for their clients, and the overall risk of the portfolio that's being supported, which would have to be verified, for example, through sampling and spot checks on the ground. But it is a different animal, so to speak, a programmatic approach. It's the same principle that applies in a community-driven development project that has hundreds of sub-projects that are not identified at project approval. This will become apparent as we move forward and we adopt more of a framework approach. So depending on what the instrument is, the procedural aspects would be different typically, but the overall policy principles of what needs to be addressed ultimately would remain the same.
Thank you very much for that little response, Ryder. We go to Bruce. Bruce, you may want to touch on our current existing practices and then the rules and responsibilities on Para 22 on the summary paper. Over to you, Bruce.
Great. Thanks very much, Felix. Thanks, Ryder. And thanks, of course, Ryan, for a really good set of questions and good to see you again today. So let me pick up on a couple of the points. Ryder's already covered quite a bit, so I'll try to focus a little bit more from the ADB perspective and what we're considering now. Firstly, on the separation of roles and responsibilities between ADB and the borrower and the clients. Now, this is a fairly important area and actually one that the Independent Evaluation Department recommended that we needed to have a clearer delineation of roles and responsibilities that currently that is not always clear in the existing policy structure, the roles that ADB has versus the borrower. And that actually can be a complicated issue when it does come to the application of the accountability mechanism and discussions with, say, the Office of the Compliance Review Panel, they would also like to see a clear delineation of those. So we're looking at how best to do that. The approach that we're considering at the moment is fairly similar to the graphic that Ryder had in one of his slides where he was presenting the sort of structure where you would have, firstly, the sustainability vision or commitment of ADB, and then you would have the ADB responsibilities, due diligence requirements set out. And that would need to cover, of course, one, we need to ensure that the clients that we're working with will comply with the policy, but substantively responsibilities for the screening and categorization, for due diligence on the project in terms of, you know, understanding and assessing the risks and ensuring that the client has appropriate capacity and management systems in place to be able to implement it, as well as monitoring and supervision. That then complements a set of standards or borrower requirements. And you see this now with the majority of multilateral financial institutions where you have this structure of between 8 and 10 standards. Now it's the borrower's responsibility to ensure and implement those standards appropriate to the potential impacts and risks with the project and depending on what's triggered. Our responsibility then is essentially, you know, the due diligence and oversight and ensuring commitment, legal commitments, for example, to implement that. So, you know, we see that certainly it's giving clarity. Clearly, and to your point, you know, we need to make sure that the responsibilities of ADB are clear. We're not devolving ourselves of all responsibilities. We just want to make that clear. You made a point, of course, though, about how do affected people on the ground understand this. There would be two sets of documentation, you know, one, the requirements for the borrowers and clients, and then the responsibilities for ADB. I'm sure that we could look that, though, distilling into some documentation forms that are easy to understand at local levels, how those shared but differentiated responsibilities play out at a project level. That's something that we could put together or make clear in explanatory notes and guidance. Next, just looking at which one to take. I'll come in next just to briefly talk about the risk categorization, and then I'll come to your question, Ryan, about moving categorization up and down and the internal processes that we have in place. Firstly, so you know, it's been recommended to us, and Ryder speaks, you know, very clearly about the opportunity to move to a four-tier risk categorization, and this is something that we're looking at very carefully. I have to say, though, there's not a final decision on this. We need to take it and hear more from stakeholders, including yourselves in civil society, but also developing member countries and our private sector clients. Certainly, one thing that we're hearing already from clients, both developing member countries and private sector, is they'd like to have a clear and simple system that is consistent with other financial entities, because whether it's private sector or developing member countries, they are often co-financing or having to comply with different requirements of different agencies. And that's honestly a challenge for them. So if we in the World Bank have a four-tier risk categorization, but others have a different system, that's obviously a complication. So we need to think through about how to apply that in practice. I will say, though, there's some key tenets of risk management that we've been presenting and discussing today that we think are really important. We need to go beyond just considering the project area of influence and the direct and indirect impacts that might occur in that project. We need to broaden the scope of risk, looking at these contextual risk factors, looking at the management capacity and systems, and much more systematically assessing that. So, you know, I think regardless of whether we go to a more traditional risk categorization approach with additional risk assessment for contextual issues or a combined four-tier categorization, we'll have to decide. But certainly a broader consideration will be very important. That would be something that the ADB will have to implement. Then when it comes to financial intermediaries, I think as Ryan has said, we would be screening the risks of that portfolio, the risks of the types of investments that they would be supporting in their capacity using that risk categorization. But I'd also like to think that our expectation would be that financial intermediaries also need to look broadly at the contextual risks of the portfolio investments. Of course, we need to take a risk-based approach there. So still some work to do, and happy very much to hear your thoughts. On the dynamic categorization on how this could change, I'll firstly just say that at the moment, the categorization process starts with our colleagues in the operations. So these are staff that are working inside ADB directly with the client to understand the project, to do field missions, to have that dialogue with the local ENS specialists, and then to prepare or propose a safeguard categorization. That then comes through to our central department, the safeguards division in ADB, which I lead, and we have a range of environmental and social safeguard specialists. The safeguard categorization forms then goes separately for an environment review and then separately for a social review on involuntary resettlement and Indigenous people safeguards. That then comes to me to do a further review, and then after that it goes to our Chief Compliance Officer. Any changes due to unanticipated impacts or changes in scope in the project, again, follow that same process. Now, if we were going to make this more dynamic, for example, for it to be reviewed as part of monitoring missions, if context has changed, if something has occurred, you could embed a process where at an annual basis or as needed, the categorization is then rescreened and reconfirmed if there are any changes. So you can bring in a dynamic approach and also with checks and balances along the way. So that's the way that we would be seeing that to evolve. Now, I think that I've covered the majority of points. Ryan or Felix, let me know if I've missed anything. And Ryan, please come back for any further clarifications and comments. Thank you.
No, pretty much you touched on everything, Bruce. I was going to ask you to stay on. We got a very simple question, which I think you may be the best person. So if you don't mind coming back, Bruce. That's a follow-up question. I understand Myra Batt, who is a Policy Engagement Officer or Osfam International UK, is not on the call, but what she would like to know is how can smaller projects comply with the requirement? So smaller project, I reckon, whether financial threshold or maybe TRTAs or, but it was quite blanket, smaller project, how would they comply with the policy requirement?
Several levels here, and Ryder may have some perspectives on this as well. Firstly, the screening and assessment of risks obviously has to take into consideration the scale of the project, its potential impacts, as well as the other contextual risks. So, you know, smaller scale projects in our existing categorization process would usually be, depending on their nature, either category B or category C, so less likely to have significant impacts and risks, or having minimal or no impacts and risks. So that's the first starting point. Then, of course, the safeguard requirements or standards to be followed then depend on those that are triggered for a particular project. So if you're looking at a very small project, it may not be that they have potential for all of the standards to be triggered, or if they are, the scale and magnitude or the likelihood of those impacts would be lower, and therefore the management requirements may be less. So that's how you can also take sort of a scaled approach.
Yeah, I think thank you very much, Bruce. We're getting a bit more questions coming up now. So good. I think it's quite very, very clear. We've got quite a few hands. I just want to acknowledge that we noticed you've posted your question. We're going to be calling in this order. We've got Fitria, Lily. We've got Joanna as well. And we've got Mayang as well, and Nadine. So if you just be a little bit patient with us, we'll try and reach to all of you. But while we have the call, we can start with Fitria. You are an environmental safeguard specialist for PLN in Indonesia as well. And your question is, would there be any technical guidance on how to assess specific issues? If you're on the call, maybe Fitria, you may voice your question. I noticed you're on the call, because you talked about vulnerabilities assessment. Are you on the call? And would you prefer to speak, Fitria, Lily? You can unmute and speak. Okay, all right. Okay, I'll read out your question. Your question as well. It says, would there be technical guidance to assess specific issues? And here you mention an example, vulnerable groups. And then another question you had was how ADB considered the national requirement on ENS into updated new ADB SPS. In regard to assessing risk, in my opinion, the assessment could also consider the capacity of the partner to manage the risk assessment. So two or three questions, which I'll pose first to Ryder. The first one has to do with, would there be any guidance on how to assess specific issues? You made reference to vulnerable groups. Maybe Ryder, you may want to also touch on that intersectionality on the vulnerability risk factors. And the other question has to do with, would the policy update take consideration of country national requirements and then capacity of the borrower? I'll post to Ryder first, and then maybe Bruce may want to retort to that one as well. Over to you, Ryder.
Thank you. Let me take the point on capacity first. Yes, I apologize for going through the slides very quickly with a limited time, but capacity is exactly one of those risk factors that we should be taking into account. There was one slide where we listed some different categories of risks, And we talked about performance-related issues, including capacity, but also resources and commitment or political will. In my own experience, political will and commitment is almost the most important of all of these, since you can build capacity with appropriate support, but it's very hard to do anything unless there is the political will to do it. So that's very much a risk factor that can exacerbate or mitigate other risk factors, depending on how they interact. Secondly, is there technical guidance? Yes, there is a large number of different documents that have come out in recent years, and we continue to issue guidance on specific topics as we learn more about those. The IFC, when I was the manager there, we had a problem in a project in Honduras and Central America, where security forces working for the project we were financing actually killed local peasants, local agriculturalists in conflict over land. And it made it very clear that we had underestimated the risk of abuse of force by security forces. So we issued a large and I would say good handbook on the appropriate use of security forces. Very recently, the issue of violence and retaliation against stakeholders has come up as a key concern in the discussion among all the multilateral financial institutions, something that civil society has been pointing out for years. And IFC and IDB Invest recently co-published guidance on how to deal with risks of retaliation. Now, these are guidance documents. It would really be up to the individual institution how much of this would be made mandatory procedural compliance-related requirements. But it's meant to be advice. It's not initially written as requirements. There was a question about why guidance is not mandatory in all cases, and that's a choice that has been made, this three-tier approach. And if I can be immodest, and I have written a couple of handbooks that have been published by multilaterals, one on appropriate and meaningful stakeholder engagement that the Asian Development Bank published together with a number of other development finance institutions, including the World Bank, the IDB, and others. I posted a link in the chat room. I also wrote a handbook on precisely identifying a broader set of social risks, which was published by the Inter-American Development Bank. And I'm posting the link to that here, just as examples of a relatively recent guidance that has been issued. The social assessment handbook has some procedural aspects specific to the IDB, but most of it is written in a general fashion addressing issues of indigenous peoples, of cultural heritage risks, labor-related risks, a number of other topics that people might find of interest. But these things are shared, discussed, and coordinated among the MFIs, including ADB.
Thank you very much, Ryder. I could see already a note from Aibu Leli in the chat saying a big thank you to you, Ryder. Maybe Madhu want to come and touch on the vulnerability in terms of the ADB perspective. And then Bruce may want to touch, or Madhu yourself, you could also touch on the CSS. Would the SPS update take notice or cognizance of national requirements? Madhu?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And thank you, Ibu Leli, for that question on vulnerability. Now, Ryder has explained, the part of the intersectionality and why it is important to address these risks. In order to really ensure that these risks are actually captured at the level of project, what is also important for us to really, really look into ADB internal systems. As you know that, in when we process a project, we have the initial poverty social analysis, which is followed by the poverty social assessment, which also identifies the different risks and vulnerabilities in projects. And it is the scope of that process is much more wider than that we follow for assessing risk of involuntary settlement and indigenous people as well. So it really maps out the beneficiaries, who are the vulnerable groups, and how disproportionately are they going to get affected. So as we know that there is a certain format over there, so currently within ADP, we are trying to relook into those procedures and first to see that whether the definition of vulnerable groups, what the other MFIs have adopted, what is very, what is suitable in terms of definition of an expanded definition of vulnerable group in the context of Asia Pacific. And then also build in and improve and strengthen the system of poverty social assessment. We also have a technical assistance, which is looking into it. So it will also come up with guidance on addressing these vulnerabilities. So that really gives you, as a writer explained, I like his example, that you get with a wide lens, you know, camera, where you see all these vulnerabilities in a project. And then from there, you know where your policy standard gets triggered, and then you go into more details. So this is what we actually have in mind. And when we roll out the policy update, we will definitely have guidance on how are we going to address the issues of vulnerable groups in different contexts, from the point of view of screening, resource allocation, and also what kind of training materials also will be developed, you know, for both borrowers, clients, and all others who are interested. And as Zara also indicated during her presentation, that we talked about strategic partnerships. As you know, ADB in collaboration with other MFIs also have these joint learning centers where we share our resources and where we also publish our resources together. So there are opportunities where these training programs also can be shared, and materials as well as can be shared. So I think for the vulnerability part, Felix, I would conclude over here. Now, coming to the point on what will happen with regard to
national requirements.
I don't think in terms of national requirements, addressing national requirements, things will not change in the revised policy. As you know, the current SPS, we are obliged to follow national regulations. And what we do is we do a gap analysis between our requirements and what is there in the national requirements, and then we adopt gap filling mechanisms. So similarly, even if we move towards a performance standard model, we will again assess that against the national regulations that are there and see the gaps and build along those lines in terms of what are the additional due diligence that are needed in terms of gaps, you know, gap filling measures, you know, to fill up those gaps between the national requirements and the ADB revised SPS. So I don't think that would change in any case. But obviously, we are also thinking of how to, you know, have a more strategic approach in terms of capacity building of DMCs. Now, capacity building of DMCs can have various levels. It can be at the level of, you know, improving, you know, regulations. It can be at the level of capacity building of specific agencies who are actually borrowing from different MFIs, so that it helps them build their systems and adapting international best practices. So I would stop here. Maybe Bruce could add something more on, you know, the one on the national regulations part, and maybe something on the capacity building part as well in terms of what we are thinking.
Thank you. Yeah, Bruce.
Felix, thank you. I think Madhu's covered quite well in terms of the approach to national regulations, gap analysis. But on the capacity side, I'll just briefly add that, of course, going to a broader approach to risk assessment, as well as more integrated environmental and social risk assessment, and a broader consideration of vulnerable and disadvantaged groups, does imply the need for strength and capacities. And that's going to be quite a work that we have to undertake. We're already planning for that. Actually, we have a proposal for a technical assistance to be approved next year to help us with the rollout of the policy, where we'll be developing training, support, capacity development and awareness raising materials that we then roll out at regional and country levels, and then at project levels for specific clients. That will be a piece of work that actually has to continue. And we're aware that, you know, in the first years of transitioning to a new policy, we'll need to give a lot of effort to that process. We also need to continue the work that we've been doing actually for many years with other multilateral and bilateral institutions around building local centres for excellence, such as the Safeguards Learning Centres that we've worked in Philippines, Indonesia, Vietnam and others to establish. So that process needs to continue. We also see some advantages in having some convergence with other multilateral institutions, because we have more consistency in our own requirements, then we can also jointly continue to support capacity development efforts. And we'd also like to collaborate with others, including civil society, on building capacity. So there's a lot to do in that space for sure. Thanks, Felix. Okay. Pass back to you.
Thank you very much. For that detailed response. Bruce, we've got Joanna who has unfortunately left, but we'll cascade a question. I think, Bruce, we may have to have you back. This is from Joanna Budeski. She's a manager, advisory services, Cardinal Australia. And she would want to know that how is the timing of ADB financing budget setting being considered in the update to enable development of safeguards with appropriate budgets to implement? So I think the question focuses on budget in ESIAs. How is our financing or budget setting being considered in development of safeguards policy to ensure appropriate budgets are provided for good practice ESIA and management commensurate with the risk of the project?
Great, thanks, Felix. A couple of things to mention there. One, a more robust risk assessment process and baseline assessment process for projects, particularly those with high and substantial risks, allows us to do better budgeting. Also, the assessment of management systems and capacity, which I think has not been given enough attention to date, needs to be factored in there. Now, that process of risk assessment then allows you to allocate additional resources for capacity development and monitoring. But then at a project level, the environmental and social management plans need to be adequately resourced. And a related area that we're seeking to strengthen is the links with safeguards and the procurement processes. So making sure that, for example, the environmental management plans are clearly linked and the budget requirements to those into bidding documents, also the capacity of the bidders that need to be able to implement it, and then into the implementation plans. In addition, we're thinking through at the moment things like additional contingencies for projects, particularly those with high risks. And you can also look at performance bonds or other types of financing modalities for contractors that can be linked in here as well. So that's another area of study that we're looking at. Thanks, Felix.
Thank you, Bruce. I think that's quite sufficient. We will go on just because of time purposes. We've got Mayan Azurin. Is he on the call, Mayan? Not sure. I will voice out Mayan's question. Mayan is from GAIA Asia Pacific. Your question says, understand that assessment of each project is context specific, in which the role of affected communities and civil society on the ground will be crucial. What will ADB do differently now, given the lessons we have learned in the past few years? That's the first question. And because it's ADB focused, maybe I may have to bring back Bruce. And then the second question is a threefold question. Second one says, why is there no project as an option in the risk mitigation categorization? It assumes that all risk can be managed instead of avoided. Then the third question is, what was the need for the four-tier risk categorization? Tiered report was saying the problem is under categorization for high risk project, not the lack of categories. So first question is, given the lessons we've learned, what is ADB doing differently in terms of assessment of project risk? Second question is, why is there no project as an option in the risk mitigation categorization? Over to you, Bruce.
Great, thank you, Felix. So thank you to Maya from Gaia. Maya's joined many of our consultations before, so thanks for joining again. Okay, firstly, on understanding, okay, this is the role of affected communities and what are some of the lessons from this in the past. So in brief, I think there's a lot of things that we can say about the lessons and experience for affected communities. One, and this goes to some of the other consultation topics that we've had, is the deficiencies in the whole stakeholder engagement process. And currently ADB doesn't have a specific standard for stakeholder engagement. There's a requirement for meaningful consultation and a definition on what that means, but not really a lot of specifics. So going to a more robust, thorough stakeholder identification process, stakeholder engagement planning, and then of course the consultation process needs to stem from that. It needs to begin very early, but the other lesson is that it doesn't finish at the time of project appraisal. It really needs to continue out through the life of the project, you know, throughout implementation. It will change, there will be processes of communications, we need to strengthen grievance redress mechanisms, but that whole process of stakeholder engagement is crucial. It also needs to be linked to the risk assessment and identification process and how things change on the ground during implementation. So I think these are just a couple of lessons that need to be factored into that process. The second point on why is there a no project? Why is there no project?
No project, yes.
In the risk mitigation categorization. So just to make a distinction there, the risk assessment categorization is based on looking at, you know, firstly, the potential impacts and risks of the project. And then in addition, we're considering to bring in contextual risk factors and management systems and capacity. So that's understanding the risk. But then how you then address that has to bring in a range of different options, including alternatives analysis. And that's where the assessment of a no project alternative comes into that process. That's certainly going to be maintained in the new policy. And also we need to robustly apply a mitigation hierarchy. And as Ryder's pointed out, you know, that starts with a process of avoidance. Now, that's something that needs to be considered much earlier in the process. If you only come in and do your screening and risk assessment at a late stage when you're fixed on a project option, sometimes we find that the option to avoid is no longer there. And the true consideration of whether a no project alternative is the best one also doesn't really come in. So starting that whole process earlier and more systematically is indeed very important there. And then lastly on...
Why do we need a four-tier?
Okay.
Why don't we keep what we have, Bruce?
That's a question. We could keep what we've got with the current three-tier of A, B, and C. But as mentioned today, we think you need to broaden that approach to bring in additional contextual risks and also management systems. So that's one thing that needs to change. Why three tiers versus four? Ryder might have some opinions on this as well, and to look at the rationale as to why others have changed. There's a couple of simple things that identify, and this did come out through the independent evaluation. When you have three, there is a tendency for things to fall into the middle. And that was certainly something that the IED evaluation suggested, that there was a tendency where some projects that probably should have been recognized as category A were on that borderline of, let's say, B sensitive, as we used to call it in ADB. And if you look at the bell curve, most projects do end up in that B category. We're certainly across that large cohort of ones in the B category. Some are of more substantial risk and some are really moderate to low risk. So pulling it out into four allows you to give a bit more clarity and definition as to what the risks actually are, and then to align your requirements and management systems with that. But of course, you know, there's merits of going either way, and that's what we need to consider. Thanks, Felix.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much, Bruce. We go to... next we go, Nadine. Nadine, you got your hand raised up. I thank you so much for your patience. I know we've slipped a bit of time, but if you're there, Nadine, you have the microphone. And please unmute.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear. And thank you so much. Apologies for keeping your hand up all as well.
No, that's all good. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to speak. I'll try and keep my question as brief as possible.
That would be helpful.
Yeah, so I'm particularly interested to understand how this new approach, the, you know, the dynamic risk assessment and categorization will work with associated facilities, because I feel like this was not really discussed in the paper or throughout today's discussion. So for example, we've noticed that the ADB in many has a particular pattern, for example, of financing the portions of those associated facilities which are just inherently lower risk, and that reflects in the risk category being C or B, as have been indicated as well in the IED study. There is a disproportionate amount of B projects anyway. But what is not clear, for example, is how the scoping, so the stakeholder identification and that risk assessment that's been done prior to the risk categorization within associated facilities has been done, right? Because, and I'll give you an example of a project, the railway sector investment program in India, that I think the category was C, but the portions where it was financed by the borrower being the, a sovereign government, it was A. So how does that work in terms of the stakeholder identification and the risk categorization? Because the project affected people were the same, which means that the project footprint wasn't essentially looked at properly. And so the risk wasn't commensurate of the entire project. And that means that there was an undercategorization, in our opinion, of that risk. So two questions: how does the flexibility or the adaptive dynamic risk assessment categorization work within the risk, associated facilities? And a second question would be, I just lost my train of thought.
Did you mention how we identify a stakeholder identification and consultation? Is that the second one?
No, so sorry. It would be when you talk about expanding the risk scope to including the footprint, what does that mean? So is that mean it is bound by the financial commitment that the bank is making, or is it actually looking at the entire project footprint? Because if we're talking about the railway sector investment program, it is an entire project, right? It's not just whatever the ADB funds. So we would love some clarity on that. So, and another, just briefly, I wanna talk about as well is climate risk and how that as well fits in with the new adaptive dynamic risk assessment, because we've pointed that out in previous consultation. The way the ADB currently approaches climate risk and climate change is that it only assesses the risk of climate change to the project, not vice versa. So not how there can be project-induced climate risk to project-affected people and surrounding communities. And I'm wondering how, and maybe this is beyond the scope of this particular discussion, but it would be of interest of us as well to see how within the project footprint, how will this be looked at early on? How will that be assessed in terms of risk categorization? And how will that also reflect in the risk categorization itself. So I'll stop here and would love to hear some answers on these. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Nadine. I would maybe go first to Ryder. Ryder, if you could share your experience with the World Bank or if Charles as well is around, but I think with World Bank, the four-tier dynamic categorization and associated facility, how does that apply? And hence, I think Nadine's second question more talks about area of influence, that there could be a risk of under-categorization where we focus on just where the funding and the use of proceeds are without looking at the associated facility. That's the first question. So I'll end that, and then Bruce will come and touch on the climate risks and how we're currently approaching it and how potentially the adaptive or dynamic risk categorization could help us address issues on adaptation and mitigation measures. Over to you, Ryder.
Thank you. These are excellent questions. So I'd like to make perhaps two points in relation to the associated facilities issue, and there are other related aspects also. The one is that good practice and what we're increasingly seeing institutions trying to do, and which also is in line with some international frameworks on risk assessment, is to separate the analysis understanding the risk from the determination of responsibility for managing the risks. The best example is pre-existing contextual risk factors, fragility, conflict, and violence. A project did not necessarily cause those issues and cannot be expected to address and really fix those systemic challenges in society. What the project can be expected to do and is responsible for is to assess how those factors influence the project, how the project can control for it, and whether the project itself exacerbates those issues. So I think the example that was made, for example, on climate, that there are both risks from climate-related factors to a project, but the project may also contribute to greater vulnerability in relation to climate risks. I think that is a good example of current thinking on good practice. Now, specifically on associated facilities.
Associated facility, yeah.
Yes, if I were, as I was in the past, responsible for risk classification on these issues, I would see the association or linkage with other aspects of an area, including but not limited to associated facilities. I would be looking at different tiers of the supply chain. I would be looking at a number of issues that the project could not control directly, but I would see these as risks to the project that could affect those issues I was directly responsible for. And if I were coordinating a risk classification, I would say that this could well increase the overall risk categorization of the project. Now, when it comes to how you then manage it, that is a more focused question. And there are three aspects to how you manage those types of associated risks. Number one, if there is a contribution, if you contribute to the overall risk, say through cumulative impacts or the association with third parties, you apply the mitigation hierarchy completely and fully to those aspects that are attributable to you as a project. You control for those things you can control. Secondly, you try to use the existing leverage and control you have to influence and improve on conditions with those third parties, whether they be associated facilities or different aspects of a supply chain or other aspects. Third, if you feel you do not have sufficient control or leverage, good practice would indicate that you should not be satisfied with that. You should look for ways to increase and enhance your leverage. an institution like the Asian Development Bank or the World Bank don't just have financing power, they have convening power, they have the ability to bring other resources to the table, and they can certainly influence more strategic decisions at a more macro level than the isolated investment projects, for example. So I would be looking for ways to enhance control and leverage. And finally, if the end result is unsatisfactory, and again, supply chains is probably a better example, an easier example here, I would look for ways to change suppliers of goods and materials to a project if labor working conditions, child labor, forced labor, illegal logging, if any of those things were part of the supply chain. So there's a number of steps. I think the core thing that I was trying to say is that we have tended to conflate the focus of the analysis to those things that we think we are directly responsible for. And I would suggest it should be seen as a two-step process. The analysis of risk should be much broader. And then you focus on what is under your control and leverage and responsibility to manage. And that can always be negotiated and discussed and improved upon. This is simple, if I may just add a footnote finally to that. This approach to that, those impacts that you cause, those impacts that you contribute to, and those impacts you are associated with in particular, or linkage, those are well known in the private sector particularly, because they're exactly key principles of the UN guiding principles on business and human rights.
Thank you very much for that detailed response to the question. I'm sure Nadine is quite very clarified. You could always reach out to us, Nadine, if you think you've got any follow-up question. Our last two questions will go to Bruce. Bruce, the first of the last two questions is on the same topic of climate change. Nadine's question has to do, how do you envisage, should ADB adapt to the dynamic risk classification? How would that affect our climate commitment? Adaptation, mitigation, especially for project-induced climate change impact. And maybe let me just pack this together with Tom Reddington. Tom is a sub-regional secretary of Oceania Public Services in Australia. Tom has heard about the ETM, the Energy Transition Mechanism in ADB, and significantly worried about how consultations with workers and trade unions would ensure that they minimize impacts to the privatization of the privatization leveraging of the ETM, the Energy Transition Mechanism. So if you could, you know, give response to these last concluding two questions. Over to you, Bruce.
Sure, thank you very much, Felix. Thanks again to Nadine for those questions. I just want to circle back very briefly on the question related to associated facilities, because it was a really good one. Now, Ryder has actually responded in a way that's very consistent with how we see the issues. I think you've made this very clear separation around the understanding of risk and then the management of risk. And just to say briefly, the existing policy does actually have this consideration as well. And what we would normally do is try and work with the third party to be able to manage and control risks consistent with our policy requirements. However, it does depend on the relationship and the leverage that you have. And you need to go through that process of understanding the risk, looking at how it can be managed, what influence can you have, and how can that dynamic be changed. So sometimes we have a very good, strong relationship with a borrower, and where an associated facility is quite integral to the project and the relationship, and we have some very good leverage to achieve outcomes. In other cases, our leverage may be with a private sector third party, maybe less so, and you need to then work through that process in a way similar to what Ryan has suggested. But I think we do need to look at this in the updated policy as well and provide greater clarity. So thank you again. On climate change, so we will be having a consultation on climate change, including on both climate change risk management and also mitigation side, coming up in early April. We did delay that session as we continued to work on the background paper, so apologies for that. But certainly climate change is a dynamic factor that needs to be part of the risk assessment process. You're right, Nadine, that at the moment, ADB actually undertakes a climate risk screening and vulnerability assessments for projects, but it's looking at the context of how a changing climate will impact on that project. But of course, there are interactions with a project. For example, a project that might be using water, scarce water allocations in a drying climate locally, obviously has an impact. And that could make downstream communities more vulnerable to water stress. So there's a relationship there that needs to be considered and integrated. So climate change is certainly one factor. And as we develop a set of policy standards for different issues like biodiversity or for labour, each one of these needs to be factored into a risk assessment process. Okay, and then the last question was to Tom Reddington. I think it was Tom. Yes, Tom Reddington.
Yeah, Tom Reddington, ETM.
The energy transition mechanism. Okay, and this related to engagement of trade unions.
Trade unions.
Yeah, so just on this one, I'll mention for anyone that's not yet familiar with the energy transition mechanism, this is a new approach that ADB has proposed to use a market-based approach to accelerate the transition from fossil fuels to clean energy. Essentially, we're going to be piloting a country-specific financing mechanism to speed up the early retirement of coal-fired electricity while at the same time seeking to crowd in investments around new renewable energy generation and clean technologies. So, you know, trying to get us to that net zero pathway a lot faster than would have happened otherwise. Now, the feasibility studies, the full feasibility study for this is actually still underway at the moment, and there's been work done to design the approach to environmental and social safeguards. And that includes also further work on aligning the approach with the just transition. Just transition aligned to global commitments adopted through the Paris Agreement. And there's a lot of work being done internationally around the development of the just transition approach and guidance, which will certainly be factored in. Now, Tom asked about union participation in that process. And I understand that the details of this will be still determined through the further feasibility assessments and country level processes. So I can't really say in terms of the details of that, but I can say, however, that we'll be seeking to ensure that our commitments to the core labour standards are part of the process as well. And that includes supporting freedom of association and effective recognition of the rights to collective bargaining. And certainly unions would have an important role to play in those processes as well. Now, I think, Tom, if you're still here, we can certainly put you in contact with the team that is working on the energy transition mechanism, particularly those that are leading the work on just transition. Okay, so I think I've covered that for now. I'll pass back to you, Felix.
Yes, we've got Tanya. Tanya has got her hand up, and okay. You know, we've gone a bit time. Tanya, please, if you could be very, very brief with your question, you have the floor now.
Yeah, sure. Thank Please. You very okay. much. I'm Tanya with the NGO Forum on ADB. I will be quick and I'll just keep my video off for now. First of all, I have two clarification questions. One is that I'm really glad to hear the mention of the UN Guiding Principles on Human Rights. And I was just wondering, again, going back to the first presentation, whether human rights standards, including the UN guiding principles, would be continue to be considered aspirational, or if this will be considered from the very outset as part of an assessment before engaging with clients, before engaging, for example, with companies that would be carrying out the infrastructure projects that the ADB is financing. Second clarification question is just in terms of, I know there were questions raised in the chat box, but just about the capacity building for staff and clients, the mention of guidance notes and whether these accompanying guidance notes would be subject to first, secondary consultation processes, and second, whether they would be expected to be made public as appendices or as addendums to the new SPS. Finally, just a full question is that it appears from the presentations provided so far that all expected risks, including in conflict affected areas with security guards and reprisals, et cetera, it would be possible to mitigate with the right management systems. But in this context, especially from the perspective of the forum and our members, is that one glaring gap is that neither the presentations nor the summary document consider assurances of taking into account the fundamental concept of the precautionary approach as a requirement from the get-go. So first, my question is, how will this be factored into risk assessments? And second, will the updated SPS be expected to provide clear guidance that would trigger when a project is simply too risky to proceed and tranches would be suspended without moving forward until clear proactive corrective steps have been taken? And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tanya. I'm happy I've got you, Bruce. Let's maybe crack on because we're really, really stretched out with time. The first question, would human rights be aspirational or would it be part of the assessment from the get-go project? That's the first one. Capacity building, I think, is the second one we've touched on, probably so if we don't have time. And then the second one, I think, is linked to that no project option that we touched on here, that, you know, would it, updated SPS provide clear guidance on when it's too risky to proceed with the project. And I think Tanya linked it with a precautionary approach, but it's quite clear what she meant. So three pieces of question. I think capacity we touched on, but human rights, is it aspirational or would it be inherent part of the risk assessment right from the go? Over to you, Bruce.
Great. Thanks, Felix. Thank you very much, Tanya, for joining. And great set of questions, actually. And sorry, we are short of time because each one of these actually needs some time to unpack and discuss further. But for today, I'll try to just touch on a number of points. Firstly, on human rights and the UN guiding principles. So we're still working through the issue of considering how human rights and human rights frameworks will apply to the policy. Certainly, we believe that human rights and recognition of human rights is very important and needs to be given consideration in the policy. We need to make sure of several things. One is that the government obligations around human rights and, of course, how they would extend also to any operations and private sector in a country need to be respected, reviewed, and implemented. We need to also make sure that substantive elements of human rights considerations are reflected in the policy framework. We're also looking in the context of the contextual risk analysis, how human rights considerations come into that framework. But it is a work in process and it's something that we need to also discuss with other stakeholders and the board. The capacity building. So I've spoken a bit for that, for staff and clients, very important. On the guidance notes, we will be preparing these and we will be making them available for public disclosure and consultations at a later stage. We're not expecting the guidance notes in full to be prepared as part of the approval documents with the policy. That will come through in the next stage, but they will be made publicly available through that next stage of the process. And that needs to be completed before the policy becomes effective for implementation. So two-stage process there. Then on your last point, so the broader consideration of risks, including you mentioned, you know, fragile and conflict-affected situations, risks of reprisals, et cetera, this needs to give us an understanding of the broader consideration of risks for the project. you then need to consider whether or not those are mitigatable. Ryder has spoken to this also in terms of understanding the likely magnitude of those risks, the severity of the risks versus the likelihood of them occurring. And if you were putting a weighting system, then obviously those that have got serious potential impacts, high magnitude, high severity, need to be weighted more strongly, even if they're considered maybe probability less likely to occur. But if their significance is high, that needs to be weighted more significantly. A precautionary approach, yes, I think that always needs to be taken, and you need to bring that into a judgment process about a project. I think it's hard, though, to put, you know, a line in the sand with a criterion saying when do you finance or not finance, because there are so many different variables that need to be considered for a particular project or in a particular context. What we would like to be able to do is to bring higher standards and to build capacity of borrowers and clients to be able to implement good development projects. But if we feel that we can't do that and the risks are too high, then certainly there are projects that we do have to step away from or have to work with the client to change. And I can think of, you know, numerous examples. You know, one that I was very pleased that we did step away from that ended up being financed from another borrower and then did have substantive impacts though. So you sort of trade off always this sort of judgment of, you know, is it better for us to be involved in bringing strong standards to a project? Sometimes you can't, you have to step away, but then there's risks of stepping away. So there is a judgment that needs to be made in that process, which is quite difficult. Now, we can certainly look at experience from others and how guidance can be put to that, but I don't think you'll be able to have sort of a, you know, a definitive line in the sand. It's quite a challenge. Now, obviously, those three questions, there's a lot still to discuss, so I think we'll have to come back to some of them in further consultation rounds. But thank you again, Tanya. Back to you, Felix.
Thank you very much, Bruce, for those detailed responses. I think without much ado, let me thank all of you for staying on the call. And I hand back now over to Azim for the wrap-up. Over to you, Azim.
Thank you very much, Felix. And thank you, everybody, for your contributions and inputs and the extensive dialogue in moving this conversation forward. That's been very much appreciated, and especially by the responses offered by Ryder, Charles, Bruce, of course, Sarah and Madhu, as well as others working behind the scene, including yourself, Felix Jelson and Jennifer and some others. But of course, the biggest thanks goes to the participants and stakeholders and the informants for raising the insights, the comments, the clarity of the questions and the sharing of experiences and the very constructive feedback in the collegial way it was presented. I want to reiterate that the comments on this environmental and social risks that have been received and thereafter will be considered in the final study report, which will in turn inform the revision of ADB standard and the updating on the policy statement. But please don't go yet. On your screen, please give us your feedback on this, as well as the general way in which engagement occurred. So for this specific consultation, please rank it on a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being the most satisfied to 1 being the least satisfied. How would you rate the level of satisfaction, your level of satisfaction with this particular session? If you could do that now, if you could please just tap into your keypad, a score of between 1 and 5, 1 being the least satisfied to 5 being the most satisfied, we'd like to relay the poll back to you and show you how others have voted. And then, as I mentioned earlier, we have the mentee poll, the link to which is reappearing and reposted in the chat box now. And the mentee poll gives you an opportunity to elaborate on this specific question. How would you go about improving the level of your satisfaction? And what do you think could be done more specifically to improve the level of engagement that the ADB has with stakeholders such as yourself and promote active dialogue and feedback and interaction so that these consultations are more effective and serve to inform the safeguard policy statement review to an even higher degree. So with that, I think we should be about ready to close this particular poll question. How satisfied were you? And we see that 100% ranked us a 4 or better, with 29% saying that they were somewhat satisfied and 71 highly satisfied, which gives us a bit of room for maneuver. Please tell us how specifically on the mentee poll we can go from a 4 to a 5, and what you think the opportunities are for engaging you even further, even better, into more dialogue, more discourse, more consultation that has a significant positive impact on the review of the safeguard policy statement. Thank you all for your feedback and overall participation. I now bring you back to the director of SDCC and this process, Mr. Bruce Dunn, to give us a summary of what we've heard and to walk you through the next steps after this consultation. So Bruce, could you please review the discussions and our next steps, please?
Okay, thank you very much, Azim. And look, thank you to everyone today. We had a really great set of important and meaningful questions and comments today, lots of food for thought. And I hope you've also appreciated some of the dialogue that we've shared today. We're quite over time, and I apologize for that. So I'll try to make a fairly brief summary today, but as usual, we'll be working on a summary of the consultations, which we'll be disclosing. In fact, we have a backlog of these from past consultations that we're now just working to clear and to make publicly available. So we'll be getting those out quite soon. So just to summarize a few key points, I think a lot of the discussion today focused on how we could move to a more dynamic risk screening and classification process and risk assessment, a more integrated process, certainly one that considers broader environmental and social risks together and the relationships between those, as well as broader considerations of contextual risks. So we've spoken a bit about things like considering fragility, governance, conflict and security, risks of reprisals, but also the management systems of the borrower or the client, their capacity and resources. So essentially broadening the approach that we have now for screening and categorization and risk assessment to consider those contextual risk factors and management systems and capacity. It's been proposed through a writer's presentation that we consider a four-tier risk categorization. But as I mentioned, this is something that we have to look at more. But certainly a broader risk assessment is something that we recognize. Also, it came up at the end, the consideration of human rights. And that's something that we're also looking at in the context of that risk assessment process. Next, we have proposed that we need a broader definition of vulnerable and disadvantaged groups, and that needs to be factored in more comprehensively in the risk identification and assessment process. And of course, that then cascades down to consultation and management processes throughout the project cycle. We've mentioned the need to look at the intersectionality of issues and risks. And we also are looking to see how we can build off ADB's existing and wider poverty and social analysis and link that more comprehensively to the safeguards work. We had a number of questions and comments that came up. One was on the application of national requirements, and we confirmed that current approaches will likely remain. We need to ensure that national regulations are met, but we also undertake gap-filling analysis and gap-filling requirements. And of course, our ability to, the scope of those gaps and then our ability to manage those is certainly a risk factor that needs to be considered as well. Next, we had some good questions, comments around the application to associated facilities. I won't repeat that now, but that's certainly something that we need to look at more as part of the process. But it was highlighted we do need to have a clear separation between identification of risk and then looking at the management of risks and being clear on those two steps within the process. Also, we had very briefly mention of climate change and the integration of that into the process. We had mention of strengthening the borrower and client capacities. And I've mentioned there that we need to develop a full-fledged capacity development program as part of the new policy. There was also reference to the development of guidance and questions around to what extent is that mandatory and when will it be prepared and will it be publicly disclosed? So we also touched on those. So it's just a brief summary. I don't think I've covered all of the points that we went through because it was quite comprehensive, but I think I've covered many of the key points, but we will be looking at everything, going through the recording to make a fuller summary for the session. Now, thank you again for joining today. For those of you that are continuing to join us and support the process, we will be undertaking further consultations next week, which the topic will be on fragile and conflict affected situations and small island developing states. So that relates quite closely to this topic on risks and risk management. And then the following week, we'll be having consultations on, I think, climate change. And the week after that, I think we're going to country safeguard systems. So certainly a lot still to be covered in the process. And we'll then be taking the outputs of this to feed it into the policy development. So once again, we very much welcome your participation. It's been very active and it's certainly helping us to think through the design of a better policy. Until the next consultation, take care and we hope to see you soon. Thank you again. Bye-bye.